You're not afraid of the dark, are you?
It's the sound of your death.
We keep heaven packed with fresh souls.
The peak of your civilization.
It can't be bargained with. It can't be reasoned with. It doesn't feel pity.
You're an errand boy.
Happy heresies, my beloved true seekers. Welcome to Aeon Byte on this approximately Saturday, December 6th, the year of our Demiurge 2008. Broadcast, as always and forever, from the virtual Alexandria, the state of mind where East meets West, where all roads of possibility and imagination converge for one holy instant, where your true self, your divine twin, datelessly awaits for you like the guy fixing his boat on the honey beach at the end of the movie The Shawshank Redemption.
Get busy living, or get busy dying.
We shy away from scholarly pontification and definitely stay away from New Age babble. The website is thegodabovegod.com. And I am Abraxas, in his mortal incarnation of Miguel Connor.
Your suffering will be legendary, even in hell.
Ah, sing us a song, Jehovah, you piano man. Sing us a song tonight. After all, we've been drunken guests of your galactic tavern for many zodiac cycles, listening to your ubiquitous song of salvation and damnation. You've been throwing your peanut shells of ignorance at our third eyes, blown your intoxicating pipe smoke at our faces, and switched the lyrics so often we no longer remember where the exit is to the streets where we can breathe the crystal air of inspiration.
Fear not! Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord!
Sing us a song, Jehovah! Sing us a song tonight, because we're all in the mood for a melody. Or at least you made us believe us to be the case. Sing us a song and remind us of our granulated dreams, unattained hopes, and insecurable goals. Keep us drinking the Guinness of forgetfulness and taking shooters of ego Jägermeister. Sing us a song tonight. And forever we'll be with you in the smelly carpeted, chipped wall, and smoky window tavern we call existence.
There is always hope. Only because it's the one thing that no one has figured out how to kill yet.
Except for some of us, of course. And we are called the Gnostics. We're the mystagogues you sometimes don't notice. For we're past the pool tables of genocide and the karaoke machines of compliance. We're the ones playing that old-time jazz theology.
The light that burns twice as bright burns half as long.
You see, old man, like jazz, our music is liquid and spontaneous. Our core, our very hearts, honor the melodies of the past, but we are always innovating, experimenting, and taking our euphonious notes to their extremes. We elevate our harmonies together, motivated by each other's individuality, and at the same time watching each other's musical backs. We continually take individual risks with our solos.
There is no price for individuality.
We forget sometimes how we created such beauty, but come back to it by the cadence of our soul strings, bringing with us the crowds tired of top 40 religion, billowing their moods, offering them so many alternatives of melody, and always keeping them guessing. Yes, we are the Gnostics, the jazz musicians of all histories and dimensions. And you, Jehovah, sing us that song, but we're no longer listening. We found the back porch and leapt over the wooden railing guarded by psychic lemurs and the ghostly bouncers of our guilt. And as more gather in the streets, we'll continue playing our jazz, man. and you'll find yourself one of these incarnations of the eternal universe all alone in your ghost saloon. But sing us that song tonight.
What's God? Well, you know, when you want something really bad and you close your eyes and you wish for it, God's the guy that ignores you.
Not a bad allegory in Gnosticism, eh, my beloved truth seekers? Oh well, just explaining Gnosticism is like giving Rosie O'Donnell directions to the salad bar. Continuing with our theme, Louis Armstrong was once asked what exactly jazz was. His answer was that if you're gonna have to ask, then you're never gonna know. Gnosticism requires more than concordant answers, but a special kind of ear, as Hans Jonas once said. An ear you must tune carefully and personally, whether the training is calibrated through the mysteries, religious rites, the arts, the heroic poetry and mythology that is what truly the Gnostics were writing, and a whole lot of other bits and pieces. All the talking and reading won't gain you that acquaintance with the divine we know as Gnosis. Neither will listening to this program and its bad metaphors. So why listen to it at all, then?
We find many viewers leave him on all night for comfort.
Well, for the same reason you might watch a good movie or read a good fiction book. Certain mediums will spark an esoteric curiosity within you, and mayhaps slightly awaken the divine spark within you as well. It's that first of more steps, my beloved truth seekers. It's called feeling disturbed, as the Gospel of Thomas says, and suddenly knowing that the truth is tugging at you. You are being called out of the labyrinth of the Minotaur who goes by the name of Samael.
Prepare to taste God's wrath!
And thus the truth, in her many seductions, is found at Aeon Byte, while she pulls you slowly out of Jehovah's ghost saloon. The Gnostics not only reinterpreted everything, including reality, they also deconstructed everything in their path, as Harold Bloom, the Jewish Gnostic and Shakespearean critic, once wrote. And today, or more like this eternal now, in the lovemaking of truth, that will spark an esoteric curiosity, or mayhaps slightly awaken our divine spark within, we take one of the biggest stumbling blocks in understanding ourselves and the dry rot indoctrinations we've suffered most of our lives. And that is Christian apologetics in the form of the fable of how the Orthodox Christ and Christianity came into being.
That first day, well, what do you think? It was 24 hours long?
Bible says it was a day.
Well, it was no sun. How do you know how long it was?
We've touched on these matters on past shows of Aeon Byte, but this one gives you no mystical grizzle or intellectual tap dancing. It goes for the jugular, and that's something that many individuals need to finally release what toxins they have left in their spiritual bowels. Our guest is one of the fiercest gorillas when it comes to debunking Orthodox Christianity as we know it. And this is Ken Humphreys, author of Jesus Never Existed, and the owner of the very ass-slapping site of the same name. Ken graced Aeon Byte a long time ago when we were at freethoughtmedia.com and maybe 10 people listened in every week. He recounted how literalist Christianity mutilated the classic Greco-Roman world, or more like the benign fixings of it like philosophy, art, science, and a truly elevated culture for its times.
God bless those pagans.
In this eternal now, Ken will counter the baboon apologetics of the genesis and lab growth of Christianity that are as synthetic as the cheekbones of Madonna. We will focus, because we are dealing with Gnosticism after all, on primarily the destruction of historical apologetics, If you're looking for more modern stilettos against mainstream Christianity, I advise you to go read some of the atheist mullahs like Dawkins, Harris, Sagan, Barker, and Hitchens. But be careful, because some of these cats are more dogmatic and zealous than your average Al-Qaeda CEO.
It's become appallingly clear that our technology has surpassed our humanity.
I actually do like Sam Harris a lot, of the whole bunch, since he's courteously reasonable and is a Zen Buddhist to boot. Nevertheless, we will not be mocking good Christians on Aeon Byte, simply the fable of how Christianity arrived at the pagan scene based on a mythical entity that, for the Gnostics, is far more real and reliable than a carnal rabbi who wandered the boonies of the Roman Empire.
Have you found Jesus yet, Billy?
I didn't know I was supposed to be looking for him, sir.
Since a child, I always had a problem thinking of Jesus Christ Superstar going to the toilet. Now I don't have to worry about it, because there are no latrines inside my heart, or dirty plumbing in my news, or higher mind in Greek. I draw my power, or dynamis in Greek, from the world of ideas, the pleromic kingdoms of the divine biology, or the fullness of mythopoeia. In other words, history is but one of many instruments in this jazz session. Ken comes from a secular point of view. I come from the Gnostic point of view. But we both meet and agree in the halls of free thinking and in the trenches of the war against fundamentalism and all its alluring tutus.
You know, I've looked for one verse in the Bible. I just can't seem to find it. One verse that said, if you don't like him, kill him. I really wish I could find it. Sometimes I wish God would give me a Holy Ghost machine gun. I'll blow your head off.
Sure, we've all heard it before. Jesus came along and taught 12 clodhoppers from the countryside. Then Jesus was nailed to a tree for saying too many nice things. Then his followers, superior spiritually because they own penises, spread his teachings and churches sprung across the world, faster than the building of a new NFL stadium. Instead of how one day we walked out there and were invaded by CVS pharmacies and Starbucks, the pagans were suddenly surrounded by churches and Christians throwing themselves at lions. The Holy Ghost, like a metaphysical Ferrari, accelerated this movement, and before you knew it, the Roman Empire was Christian.
I give you the Buddy Christ.
The church was born. Doctrine remained the same as it had when Jesus was multiplying baguettes, and salvation was at your fingertips if you would just learn to feel bad while society told you to feel good. What a wonderful circus this array of hope and fellowship. Yeah, what a load of Jabba the Hutt manure. The reality is much different, and Ken will more than add solar flares to this, my beloved True Seekers. For a mammoth more of evidence and information on our interview, please visit his website, JesusNeverExisted.com.
There's no pleasing some people.
That's just what Jesus said, sir!
Sorry, Jehovah. There is goodness in churches, Christian hospitals, and religious communities, but our thirst cannot be quenched by your saltwater tumblers. We are the Gnostics, and want the sexy truth, no matter how much it makes us outlaws of the spiritual world, which many of us already are. We want to go beyond your rules, regulations, and just plain wanted music that resounds across the defective universe like the sound of a woman coming in the hotel room next door. Like William Blake wrote, prisons are built with stones of law, brothels with bricks of religion.
Whoa.
But please, my beloved True Seekers, never use the truth to insensitively wound others. Everyone is developing at a different stage. Cultivating that ear of gnosis also means cultivating the heart of compassion. After all, William Blake also wrote, "A truth that's told with bad intent beats all the lies you can invent." Like the great Robert Ingersoll said, "Live and let live until the fundamentalists begin violating your rights. Then it's time to push back hard."
At my signal, unleash hell.
And here at the Virtual Alexandria, we are very well armed with the armor and sword of the truth St. Paul wrote about. Play your jazz music, practice the mysteries, go courting for your lover, the truth. Pamper kindness and love, as Jesus says in the secret book of James. Balance your reason with your mysticism. Trust but verify. Don't be a stumbling block to others, as the Gospel of Truth says, no matter how lost you think they are. Help your brothers and sisters if they ask for your help. Like the Nag Hammadi Library's teaching of Sylvanus says, entrust yourself to reason and remove yourself from animalism. For the animal which has no reason is made manifest. For many think that they have reason, but if you look at them attentively, their speech is animalistic. But before everything else, know yourself. Yes, it sounds hard to do, and we all fall short. But bottom line is that you must write your own gospel and live your own myth. And in that case, you'll probably make some enemies along the way, besides the demiurge. And so it is.
That God does not like you.
But enough of my drivel. The loquacious, erudite, and witty Ken Humphreys takes us to his smithies in order to teach us how to sharpen that sword of truth. With us today, we have Ken Humphreys, author of Jesus Never Existed, and the very august website, JesusNeverExisted.com. How are you doing today, Ken?
Pretty good. Thanks, Miguel. Great to be back with you.
Oh, likewise. It's been too long, and thank you for coming back on. But before we start on the meat of the matter, on all the fun stuff, let's talk a little bit about you. How exactly did you become interested in ancient biblical history, and what was the process, more or less, of eventually coming to the conclusion there was no historical Jesus?
From a very young age, I was interested in history, and that's really the starting point. No particular interest in religion. In many ways, from a very young age, it sort of bemused me that many people took religious notions seriously, and in many cases very seriously, and that was, you know, quite puzzling me. You know, I never indoctrinated myself, and being a born skeptic, there was that distrust of religious ideas anyway, and a certain amusement at, you know, somehow that to be religious, one dressed up in silly clothes and grew a beard, it all seems somewhat theatrical and a show for simple-minded people. But it, you know, so in many ways, I just ignored religion and got on with a serious study of history. Now, that has been with me all my life. So from that point of view, as you study history, you, of course, very often come into contact with religion, its ideas, its effects, its the traumas it creates, and so on. So one acquires an attitude towards it. In my case, it was very critical, I must be honest. Though one is aware that it gives hope to the hopeless, it comforts the distressed, it clearly has big psychological appeals to many people. For the rationalists who can deal with reality, it is essentially a trick. It's a deceit. The beginnings of my studies, serious studies, because after all, most of my life I had to earn a living. You know, I couldn't indulge myself like a churchman in just reading the holy text and letting somebody else put money in the plate. But the interest was there, and particularly a fascination with the ancient world. That was my chosen area of study and interest. And of course, anyone who looks back to those times, let's be fair, it's often presented through the media, television and the cinema, the glorious world of ancient Rome. We had Gladiator a few years ago now. I mean, everyone now is aware of some of that stuff. We had that lovely series Rome that was on HBO and the BBC.
Very good.
Yeah. So there's no excuse for total ignorance anymore. But there's, of course, overlaid on that is a spurious history of invented by the church, the spurious history of their own origins. They claim to be the result of a visiting deity from heaven who born to a virgin and said some wonderful things and then necessarily died. So that we all might achieve salvation. I mean, a very curious idea when you look at it from any rational direction. But you had this idea, and then the church overlays on true history its own noble origins, that it was persecuted, that it triumphed over adversity, and then became accepted as the official religion. To anyone familiar with real history, of course, that's a slightly offensive idea that any of that was true. I felt obliged to take that bogus history to task. And instead of taking every little piece of it one at a time and say, well, what is the reality here? Did this really happen? What supportive evidence do we have for this particular notion? And of course, that is really what my website is about. That is really what my books are about. It's this methodical progress through the claims of the Christian church and putting them all to the test. And without exception, they all fall over. They all fall over. The whole idea, it becomes a transparent invention which has been given the sanction of an organized church, which had for 15 centuries, the powers of life and death, and indoctrinated the whole, or at least a significant section of humanity. Now, we have escaped that, but unfortunately, a lot of those silly notions still get credence. They still are held by people who know no better, and it's still necessary, and perhaps even more necessary, to point out some basic realities that pull the rug from underneath this silly notion. The silly notion being that God took a particular interest in the Jews and then subsequently sent his son to redeem us from sin. I mean, give me a break. Yes.
But Ken, what it comes down to is the historical method, and I've enjoyed your discussions about the historical method in the Jesus Mysteries Forum, which I go there a lot. But mm-hmm. In brief terms, what is the historical method, and why doesn't Jesus pass the test?
You touch on a very important point, because something that comes from apologists, Christian apologists, all the time is that mainstream historians accept Jesus. Now, if you look at what the works of mainstream historians, they do indeed do that. They don't do it with a great deal of commitment. They do it on this sort of the basis of probability. Now, I think they are actually being gutless and a bit shallow in that approach, because whilst many characters that we accept as historical don't have a whole body of supportive evidence, or the evidence can be very slight, but nonetheless, there's something very special about the heroes that support a world religion. Now, they really require us to look much more closely than we would at the casual characters that appear in the historical story. Because people have something to gain here. It's like the old adage, follow the money. It is not a matter of fine academic, you know, nuance about whether or not one particular character is real, another an invention. With the case of Christianity, we are required, I think, to ask a penetrating questions and ask for somewhat more convincing proof for those people. In the historical method, we obviously look at a variety of sources. We try to establish we have more than one source is wonderful. In many cases, of course, we only have one source. Now, if we have one source for a story which pops up in the New Testament, and we look at that one story and discover that there are elements of it that break all the laws of physics and really commit an offense against normal logic, then I don't think we can do what mainstream historians do, which is to rub out the miraculous and simply then accept what's left and say, well, that's probably true. Because my point would be, it's probably untrue, because these people have an agenda. They are the manipulators and organizers of a religion. You know, that's where I draw a distinction between, and if you look at some of these mainstream historical books, you will find, and it's very distressing to find it, they assume Jesus existed from the flyleaf, you know, from page one, from the first sentence. They will begin by saying, Jesus was, and then they go along to substantiate how that might, you know, some fashion be, you know, held up. If you take the move from the perspective, religion is false, and these claims need more rather than less evidence, then of course you reach this, you reach the recognition that we are dealing with fable, and not with history.
Well, what happens when can apologists come up to you and say, well, we have very little evidence of Julius Caesar. If we can accept Julius Caesar, why can't we accept Jesus of Nazareth?
Yeah, that is precisely what they do. They do that. But you see, my answer would be, firstly, they are wrong in their central proposition there. When they put that comment to, if you like, the man in the street, the man or the woman in the street, what evidence do we have for Julius Caesar? They know that the average person has no idea. You know, they are not being honest to the situation. If you asked an historian what evidence we had for Julius Caesar, there will never be any question in his answer. Because the point about someone like Julius Caesar, there is a mass of mutually supportive evidence from a multiplicity of sources. Now, that is very different from having a single sacred text that supports the existence of Jesus. There is nothing beyond that that supports this person. And therefore, what is the difference, not between Jesus and Julius Caesar, but what is the difference between Jesus and Apollo, or Jesus and Dionysus? Look, what is the difference even between Jesus and the tooth fairy? You know, if we only have a single sacred text, it is very different from what we have for someone like Julius Caesar.
But then the apologists would come back to you and say, well, we have the church fathers like Ignatius, Clement of Rome, Papias, and Justin Martyr. What's the problem with relying on this ragtag bunch?
Well, yeah, okay. It's the trouble is, a lie supported by another lie does not become a truth. Now, I would challenge anybody to present a biography of any of the 12 apostles, or a biography of any of these church fathers that are brought forward to support the existence of the apostles that supposedly support the existence of Jesus. Because what do we know about Ignatius? We have a fantastic story of his martyrdom. You know, he was supposedly a major bishop of Antioch for 30 years, and yet we have nothing from that period of his bishopship at that of Antioch. We have none of his sermons. We have none of his letters. We have nothing from any other source substantiating was there. What we have is this fabulous fable of his martyrdom, and a collection of letters then attributed to his name, which come not from his period of service to the church, but come from this fantastic journey that he takes to Rome. Here, you know, if you rub out all the improbabilities from the story, Ignatius, that one, there is nothing to substantiate his persecution. You know, two, there is nothing to substantiate why on earth, when the Roman state is at war on the Parthian front, they should set aside a whole squad of soldiers to accompany Ignatius, not just to Rome, but touring the whole of the Eastern Mediterranean. And Ignatius moves through the Eastern, the cities of Roman Asia, like he's an Eastern potentate. He holds court. He calls people to him. He sits down and writes letters and slowly moves on. You know, the whole story, rubbed of its miraculous element, amounts to nothing. We just have a story of his martyrdom. And in fact, we don't even have that. The story ends before he gets to Rome. So, yeah, it's a long answer to a short question, but a very pertinent question. You know, the witnesses brought forward to substantiate Jesus are even flakier than the original story itself.
So basically, other church fathers built upon this legend, like Clement of Rome and Polycarp and so forth, and one thing led to another.
If you like, well, there is an interesting, and it's probably the central question of New Testament study. You know, where do we depart from the fabulous legend and enter real history? Now, real historians will acknowledge there is a black hole between the sacred pageant that gets played out in Palestine and the functioning church that we can identify in the late second century. We can, with reasonable confidence, believe that Justin's so-called martyr may have existed. We can certainly be confident that someone like Irenaeus of Lyon existed. But we are in the late second century. Now, from that point forward, we can trace the luminaries of the church as such as they existed. But in that gap of about 150 years, we have very tenuous support for anything. And unfortunately, it takes the form of fabulous stories. You know, what do we know about Polycarp? Another martyrdom story. We don't know much about, if anything, about his origins, the time that he was bishop. But we have this fantastic story of his execution. And if you read the story, amazing things happen. You know, when the troops come to arrest him, he offers them food. They sit down for a meal. The guy is turned into a regular hero, and he's supposedly already about 90 years old. It presses the point about credibility to the absolute limit. In fact, beyond that, it presses it to breaking point. And what apologists do, unfortunately, they can stand up and mention Polycarp, and they can mention Irenaeus, and they can mention Ignatius and the rest of the gang, and they know full well almost nobody, if not nobody in their audience, will know a damn thing about them. And yet it is almost as if they're presenting somebody who's flesh and blood like themselves. You know, they give testimony by citing non-existent or fabricated characters.
But Ken, the trump card that apologists would use against your argument would be, of course, Paul of Tarsus.
Paul can be said to be one of the many crucial links. It's true. Now, Paul. I have been on Paul's trail now for the last several years. both metaphorically and literally. I have been visiting the sites of Paul's journeys in the Eastern Mediterranean for the last several years, and I've covered about half the journey now. So that recently I was up in Philippi, I've been to Thessalonica and down to Corinth and so on, and I've been along the coast of Asia Minor. Now, of course, you know, what do you expect to find if you go there in the 21st century of Paul? You find nothing, of course. What you find is evidence of the church celebrating the sacred story. That's what you find. But what you can do is test out the validity of Paul. I will say this much of Paul. Somebody wrote the Pauline epistles. There can be no doubt about. We have the Pauline epistles. We don't have the original ones. No way do we have the original ones. But we have copies that date from probably the year 200 or thereabouts. So already we've had long enough for a great deal of editing and rewriting and so on. But let's assume that at least a few of the Pauline epistles are genuine. Okay, so somebody wrote them and he may have been called Paul. That much I will accept. That much I will accept because you can say they exist, they have a common style. It's quite clear some religious bully is behind that those letters, right? Somebody wrote them.
Right.
Now, I call them letters. I'm being generous there. I don't believe any of them are letters. And, you know, I did a comparison of some of the Pauline, if you take the body of the Pauline letters and consider them solely from the point of view of costs of production. If Romans, for example, was really written by Paul as a letter, it would constitute the longest known letter from the ancient world. If it's approximately three times the longest letter of Cicero, for example. Now, if you bear in mind that Cicero was a very wealthy Roman aristocrat who could afford to write letters, can you really, you know, allow that a lowly Jewish rabbi or Christian missionary could finance the wherewithal to write the longest known letter of the ancient world? How reasonable is that? How reasonable is that he could have then entrusted this volume, which is much larger than many early books, entrusted it to somebody and sent it to a church that he had never visited? You know, the whole thing, you know, it's questionable. Now, my whole point about Paul is that if you trace the journey mile by mile across the ancient world, and it is spelled out in the books in, you know, reasonable detail for the New Testament, you know, if you trace that journey, you just stack up one improbability after another. To illustrate that point, Philippi, okay? The sacred story tells us that Paul in Philippi was imprisoned in a cell, and it turns out only overnight. Now, he was released by the occurrence of an earthquake. The earthquake released his shackles and opened the doors, but glory be, didn't bring the roof down on his head. You know, we've all seen pictures of earthquakes, even if we haven't experienced them. What is the chances of that? You know, such a localized earthquake that it only affects one small corner of the city and opens the doors and releases his shackles. Your mainstream historian would there agree, well, that's an embellish, you know, that bit we can discount. But if you rub that bit out, can you actually still accept the second bit? That when that escape occurred, the jailer then fell to his feet and prayed to whoever God that Paul represented, and then converted him and his entire family on the spot. Is that likely? Did the jailer convert on the spot because of the earthquake? Well, if the earthquake is improbable, in fact impossible, is that bit possible at all? You know, that's what I mean. If you trace the Pauline story step by step, it gets more and more ridiculous. Let me tell you another one, right? Very different from the little incident in Philippi. You know, On Paul's final journey back to Judea, he supposedly is in a hurry and decides to sail past the city of Ephesus. And he stops instead about 100 miles away at the port of Miletus. And what does the story tell us? He then sent for the senior clergy of Ephesus to come to see him off, and they come, and he then gives them a little a sermon, in fact, quite a long sermon by the standards of the New Testament. He gives them a little farewell message. They have tears in their eyes. They're all very sad. Paul knows, of course, he knows what's coming, and yet he leaves them and goes on. Now, Christians might be happy to accept that story, but put it to the test of rationality. Paul is sailing back to, he wants to get back to Judea for I think it's a Pentecost, right? He decides to sail past Ephesus and settles and the ship comes into Miletus. Now, if you look at a map today, you will see the distance between those two cities involves crossing between, you know, some quite high mountains and then making a journey of perhaps, well, let me see, it's about, if I remember rightly, about 30 or 40 miles. Right. So you have to, first of all, allow for Paul to send his messenger up to Ephesus, the messenger to pass the message on to the senior clergy of Ephesus. They then gather together and pass down to Paul, and then he delivers his sermon. So you're always thinking, hang on, it's going to take the messenger going north 2 days and the rest of them coming south another 2 days, and the guy is supposedly in a hurry, and he sailed right past the port where they're coming from. Now, what makes it even more ridiculous is if you look at a map of that part of the coastline from the period we're talking about. Now, you'll actually notice there is a lake there today, but the lake of today was a gulf in the first century. Now, that gulf meant between Miletus and Ephesus, there was a body of water. So his messenger going north would have had to get a boat to cross to the other side and then make the land journey. The senior clergyman coming south would have had to make get a boat to cross the gulf into the port. And this is supposedly in the context of being in a hurry, and when the alternative was simply for Paul to call into the port of Ephesus in the first place. Now, as briefly as I can, I've explained, I hope, the story under analytical analysis does not hold up. Because, and you see why it doesn't hold up, the sole purpose is to present that little sermon about Paul's farewell and the sadness on the part of the elders of Ephesus as a possibility, sailing past, then sending someone back, the rest of them coming to see him. It doesn't hold up. Paul's story at many different places, in fact, all the steps of the way, does not make sense. Therefore, my position on Paul, and I would have this argument, in fact, I will have this argument shortly with theologians, is that thus somebody wrote the epistles, they are not letters, and Paul did not make those famous journeys.
And even beyond that, Ken, do you see Paul's Jesus as the same Jesus as the Jesus of the Gospels?
No, I do not. No, I do not. You know, and it's a fair point. Fair point. People argue over whether there is any support within the Pauline epistles for an historical Jesus. And there are a few verses, to be sure, where it would, if you like, not be incompatible with that idea. And we could take up time arguing on those particular points if we wished. But it's getting down to the nitty gritty of, does a phrase like born of woman, does that support an historical Jesus? You know, it's not incompatible with that. You could describe, you know, you could describe me as born of woman. I could describe you as born of woman. It's a very strange phrase to use in that context. But, you know, there is nothing, you know, the more powerful thing to read in Paul, it's the fact that nowhere does he mention Mary, for example, maybe born of woman, but, you know, he doesn't mention her mother, you know, Jesus's mother once, you know. But Paul's Jesus, to come back to your original point, Paul's Jesus has the flavor of an emanation from God. And this is how the early sun god worshippers had thought in terms of God is this unknowable, remote entity who cannot be polluted by base matter by which the rest of us are damned. So he has to have a way of communicating with his creatures, and he does it via an emanation or an essence or some form that comes from him. And one form, of course, is the logos, you know, the idea of his logic or his mindset or whatever. And Paul speaks very much of this nature of God, which takes the form of Christ rather than Jesus, and the Christ can be within you, and you can become part of the Christ. And it seems to be timeless, and it seems to be not grounded in any particular historical epoch. It's both past, present, and future. And that's where I think Paul belongs, or the writer of those epistles belongs. He doesn't, although the book of Acts tries to rope him into the general story, in actual fact, if you read the epistles, it gives no support, I don't think, for any historical Jesus.
So needless to say, you don't buy it all, which is the linchpin of the church of Peter going to Rome and being the first pope.
Well, I mean, you know, am I being perverse to say, well, where is the evidence of that?
No, not at all.
You know, we have here, you know, this supposedly ill-educated fisherman. You know, we have nothing in the Gospels that suggests that he goes to Rome. There's nothing in the book of Acts that suggests he goes to Rome. It becomes a church legend. And from an early date, maybe, but not one that has anything that really supports it. I mean, I'm sure, Miguel, you're familiar with all that funny stuff relating to digging up bones under the Vatican.
Right.
You know, how many chicken bones and pig bones do we have to find before we decide, well, it's not actually St. Paul at all. But, you know, as far as the Catholics are concerned, that's a well-established, of course. But there's nothing in a historical record that shows that Paul was St. Peter was ever in Rome. Nothing. I mean, you know, if we had something we could consider, but when there's nothing, it's just a church legend. And you only have to think of, look at the church legends that we have. They're just stories of fantasies without, you know, they're more fantastic than most children's stories.
That is very true. And again, we hear from only from the church fathers in the second century when Peter starts coming into the scene.
Yeah, that's right. You see, I can give a very rational explanation as to why Peter is moved from his... Well, he disappears in the book of Acts. You know, the book of Acts fails to complete the story of Peter. He just is no longer mentioned, because round about chapter 15 or so, the whole shift of the book of Acts moves to St. Paul. There is a reason why the church in Rome would want him there, because every church that existed in the early phase as an autonomous unit under its own bishop was making claims. And after all, what churches would have the best claims? Well, one would assume probably Jerusalem would have the best of all, because this was where Jesus worked his magic. But then, of course, you do have Caesarea nearby. You know, you have Antioch, where they became the first Christians, so we're told. You know, every other center had a claim to leadership. Now, by moving Peter to Rome, you therefore underpin the claims of the Roman church, not only to have a role to play, but to have the central role to play. And so for political reasons that occurred. And that's that process. It's not me dreaming it up. You can find our churches throughout the whole Eastern Mediterranean and beyond, even Spain and elsewhere. You know, they grabbed somebody from the holy story and decided that person had been in their particular part of the world and had, you know, was their originator. And what undermines that is the fact that several churches claim the same person. And so quite happily, the church lives with this ambiguity that the founder of one church is the founder of another church, and they're in conflict logically, but the church lives with the divine mystery of it all.
Another tool or another weapon that Christian apologists use is they go to the pagan historians like Pliny the Younger, Tacitus, Suetonius, and others. Why doesn't their testimony help the argument for a carnal Jesus?
Well, as far as the apologists are concerned, it not only helps the case, it actually proves the case as far as they are concerned. I mean, you know, they have got this worked out in infinite detail. It's only all their lovely little pamphlets and booklets, you know. They teach those who will be on the evangelical crusade which ones to quote and which verses to quote. What they don't do is put it into a context. You know, for example, yes, you will find, you know, Pliny the Younger gives some support to the existence of Christians, but they don't perhaps explain, well, it's not really support for the Jesus of Nazareth story. And nobody really questions that there were Christians by the early decades of the second century. Yes, there were people calling themselves Christians by then. But, you know, if we prove that we've found somebody who believes in flying saucers, is that any evidence for flying saucers? You know, we can find evidence for Christians. That's not the same as finding evidence for Jesus. Now, there are, if you like, the usual suspects here. You mentioned a couple of them. There's Pliny, there's Tacitus, there's Suetonius. And then beyond that, they get, and of course, Josephus. But then beyond that, they get flakier and flakier in terms of witness. But those testimonies come out all the time. And the problem with those testimonies is they are all dubious. And that isn't, again, not me inventing it. It's because the very nature of the fact that those testimonies cannot stand rigorous examination. You know, the most famous of them all, of course, as you would know, is the so-called Testimonium Flavianum. Right. Now, that testimony is simply a paragraph in the great works of Josephus, the first century Jewish historian. Now, every single source, including apologetics, acknowledges that paragraph has been tampered with. But I would question, really, the honesty and integrity of their method there, which is to say, well, let's remove the bits that are obviously fake and then insist that what remains is genuine. You know, that is a dreadful, dreadful practice because, you know, we could probably make every statement ever made legitimate if we reserved the right to rub out the offensive bits and leave what seems plausible. And that is what they do with Josephus. Now, with some of the others, you know, there's this famous story of, you know, did Nero, for example, burn Christians in his garden?
Right, that's a famous one.
That's a famous one, isn't it, Bernie? Now, you know, yes, it is mentioned in Tacitus, but what we should set against that is the fact it is not mentioned by Josephus, and more to the point, is not mentioned by Dio Cassius either, who gives a very long explanation for the fire in Rome under Nero, and he says, you know, he mentions that Nero used people to set the fire to the city. And he did so in order then to extort money out of people after the fire for his own purposes. But in a long statement on the fire, he never once mentions the Christians. Now, he, like Josephus, delights in mentioning all the, if you like, the horrors of you know, people like Herod the Great and Nero and so on. He would have mentioned it if it was known to him, but it was not. So it already clouds this validity of testimonies which appear, of course, in documents to whom we are obliged to the church for copying them. So our, if you like, the people who have most to gain by having these witnesses are the very people who produced the documents. They have copied them. And how difficult is it to insert a paragraph between two existing paragraphs? You know, that's why those examples, which they will go on using forever, of course, you know, are all beyond reasonable doubt.
And it, I guess it's worth mentioning, too, that for every historian that might allude to a historical Jesus, aren't there like 10 that are completely silent on them, like Philo and others?
Very true. You see, that is another damning statement of the claims of the church to having a valid early history. The very people we would expect to comment on Jesus of Nazareth and his followers and the growth of the church make no such mention. They really do not. Philo Alexandria, a wonderful example. Why? He's in the right place at the right time. He writes about the Jews. He writes about religion. And we have masses of his material still extant, right? The problem is he doesn't mention the Christians at all. He doesn't mention Jesus of Christ, Jesus of Nazareth. We know that he visited Jerusalem. We know that his brother financed a lot of the decoration of the temple. And so there he is, intimately involved with the royal family of Judea, on the ground, in the right place. He doesn't mention anything. And we are grateful for the fact that he mentions one thing, that his work exists at all, because at some considerable length, he discusses the Logos. He discusses how God communicates his wishes to humanity through this spiritual instrument called the Logos. Now, that was manna from heaven for the Christians, because although it didn't support their sacred story, it did at least fit into it a little bit. And that's why, you know, John, in the John's Gospel, this pick up in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the rest of it. The Philo could be used, and the Christians could use Philo in the same way the Christians could use Josephus. There were other Jewish historians whose works did not survive, but they were able to insert in Josephus, plant a paragraph that suited their interests, and therefore those works survived. So it's a two-edged sword. We are grateful that they did that, because some of these works survived because of it. If they hadn't have done it, they would have gone into the bonfires of the rest of classical knowledge.
But Ken, I think this really begs the question, and the question would be, why Jesus? Why do you think Jesus came on the scene and survive as the ultimate Gentile God-man with Jewish roots? I mean, why not use Judas the Galilean or Melchizedek, the Egyptian, or some of the other famous Jewish heroes of the first century? Why Jesus?
Okay, well, in a way, it almost boils down to why use that name? Why use that name rather than any other name? My position on this, Miguel, as I know you are aware, is that we are talking of syncretism. We are talking of the emergence of a common world culture from a whole number of what were formerly, until the time of Alexander, largely isolated civilizations. But when Alexander created the Hellenistic Empire, and that later got consumed by the Roman Empire, you had globalization, to coin a phrase. Now, globalization then meant that many gods were in the marketplace, dozens of them, hundreds of them, and in such a competitive marketplace, it was in borrow ideas one from another, and you began to get hybrid, began to get elements of a known god being merged in God. Now, that process continued over several hundred centuries, and you might ask, well, why one particular god? Well, of course, there was never one particular god until fairly late in the day. Christianity had to compete with the mystery religions. Christianity had to compete with Mithraism. You know, Christianity had to compete with a number of other Jewish sects. And really, that milieu continued really until one particular faction of Christianity got the imperial endorsement. Now, that was late in the day, as you know. That was in the early years of the 4th century. Until then, it was a competing marketplace. Now, But Christians obviously had endorsed the notion of a Jesus by then, and we know that the name was a sort of sacred name. It's also a very common name. The attachment to Nazareth has its own origins in terms of, well, it wasn't from the town at all. It was from some other meaning of the word Nazareth. You have the idea of the Christ, which is possibly coming from the group that was surrounded the writer of the Pauline epistles, and you had the idea then of giving this God of which has everything the appropriate titles, and of course Jesus that we know from the New Testament has a great many titles. He's the light, and he's the bread, and he's the water, and he is everything that you can find previously given to other gods, and he just takes the whole lot and becomes this one size fits all.
The point of the church deciding to create a unified Jesus probably happened towards the end of the second century with Irenaeus and Tertullian and those guys, right?
Well, indeed, yes. And of course, not only is Christianity competing with many non-Christian faiths, within itself, it's an umbrella term. The church likes to think, or will often maintain, that it was some sort of orthodoxy as a mainstream, but that's not the case. There were many conflicting factions. Now, those conflicting factions were themselves arguing, as you know, they were arguing whether Jesus was God or an emanation of God or, subordinate to God. Was he part human, wholly human? Yeah, did he have two natures, one nature? You know, how literal was he? Did he only appear to die? Did he really die? Did he really suffer? The number of issues was enormous, and there were various factions holding all those particular points of view, and it was only in the fight, in many, in both literally and in literature, it was the fight for some unified dogma that the Jesus story we know now emerged. And it's very interesting that all these luminaries of the early church, their main work was always against the heretics. They all seem to come out with this body, this important document condemning heresy. Now, that tells us quite a lot. It tells us that we are hearing the voice of the survivors. We are hearing the voice of the victor, and everybody else, of course, is marginalized as this quite inconsequential, an annoying sect that had a slightly incorrect view. And of course, and one wonders, well, why did it cling on so tenaciously then? The Church of Marcion, for example, was still in evidence, after several centuries. If these churches were so inconsequential, why did they have such a following? Why did the church have to, wage war against them for so long if orthodoxy was this great flagship sailing across the Mediterranean? The Jesus story we have it now, which of course, as all the elements of a glorious pantomime, which everybody knows in infinite detail, is a cultural construct. It has no particular connection to an historical event. It borrows elements from history to bolster the story. That is the very nature of religion, isn't it? It has this, charged view of reality and packages it in a nice little story. I mean, every part of the Jesus story can be told in a few words. They're simplistic little yarns that even a child can learn, and it passes for having some semblance to history, but it is not in any sense history.
To round off, I guess since we last spoke, or in the last few months or so, what exactly have you added to your website?
Okay, well, since the site has grown in leaps and bounds since we spoke before, major elements have, of course, been the Pauline story, journeys with an apostle, as I often call it, tracing his story and testing that. Now, that now amounts to 8 or 9 distinct articles which traced the story, of course. And there'll be another couple when I finally get round to visiting Antioch and so on to go with that. One of the lovely tributes, if you like, to the website is the fact that now it's now a major elements of it now appear in 9 languages. And yes. And that is done by volunteers all around the world who give up their time to put into their own language the articles that I've written. So that's wonderful. That's wonderful. Other stuff that we're dealing with, I've been taking a long, hard look at the claims for the city of Jerusalem, because obviously, whilst we've been speaking about Christianity today, I mean, it is really simply an offshoot of Judaism, and Judaism really, you know, is as flaky as the face that it gave birth to. You know, there's been a very interesting book published recently by an Israeli professor who simply says, you know, there's this story of the Jewish race really only existed in the last 100 years. That before that, everyone acknowledged that Judaism was a religion, and yet we've been all sold on this idea that firstly they were dispersed across the world, and now that in Israel they represent a sort of return to the land that they once came from. And here is a historian, is Israel, an Israeli historian, actually saying that's not true. That's another myth.
Wow. So basically, we just had. Are you saying for most of modern history, we just had a lot of Jewish sects spread across the world?
Much of the creation of the so-called Jewish diaspora is actually the result of evangelization by Jewish missionaries. You know, this is not the original race of Judea being distributed across the world. This is Jewish missionaries, you know, visiting tribes in North Africa, the Berber tribes in North Africa, you know, visiting the Arab tribes in the Arabian Peninsula, visiting Asiatic tribes in Central Asia, converting those people to Judaism. You know, in much the same way you might have Jehovah's Witnesses today converting, you know, African tribes to be Jehovah's Witnesses. It's an important distinction. At the end result might be the same. You have a Jewish population, but they are not of any common race. They are of a common religion and maybe of a common culture. But, you know, it rather undermines the claim that as a people, as a race, they can return to the land from which they came, because they did not come from that land.
Oh, and what's the name of the book?
The book is by Shlomo Sand. The book is by a professor of Tel Aviv University, Shlomo Sand, and it's When and How Was the Jewish People Invented? You know, now, of course, it will take a long while to these ideas to get through to the general public. They will go on believing the fairy tales for a long while. I mean, this is a sad thing, and we have to re-argue the same points over and over. I mean, the number of times that people will have the audacity to come on, send me an email saying they've looked at my website, have I considered Josephus? You know, now, you know, when he's mentioned in, I think, 56 different articles, I think, what have they done? Looked at the front page? Looked at the first paragraph?
And Ken, what I want to know, obviously, as we spoke before in the interview, is when does the second book come out, and what goodies are we to expect from your new book?
Okay, well, the new book will be even better than this last book. Put it that way.
Whoa.
It will be a lot of the material that's been published so far. I hope to really encapsulate all the stuff on St. Paul up front in the second book, right? That will be a major element. I also want to at least introduce the spread of the faith, particularly in parts of the world, such as the Americas, you know, and because I've discovered that particularly among the Americans, there is a very much an interest in their own immediate past. And that, I think, it will be useful to bring that into the book as well. So there's a little bit of I've got to make a few decisions there about what's to make the volume coherent. But I certainly want to deal, if you like, the common element to that is the spread of the faith. Not just the creation of the faith, but the spread of the faith and how it really moved across the world and still does. And you know, and one sees common elements, of course. One sees things happening in the first century, in the second century, that are happening in the 20th and the 21st century. The same techniques of deceit, they're time honored. They work, and people are essentially still the same. You know, there are an awful lot of ignorant people, and there are an awful lot of gullible people. And while that continues, so will Christianity.
That's true. And I've always thought, and I don't know if you agree with this, but I think most Christian scholars probably deep down in their heart know, or at least can say, that it's probably, you can't make a reasonable assumption there was a historical Jesus. But at the same time, they will never say this. They don't say this simply because of fear of losing their jobs or their reputation, right?
You have, again, touched upon an important point. Theologians are aware of a great deal of what I say on my site. They are. And if I've recently been reading a book by Rowan Williams, the Archbishop of Canterbury. Now, you know, the guy is intelligent. The guy is educated. The guy knows a lot about the history of his religion. And he will and does express these grave doubts, these areas of uncertainty, this sort of niggling area of doubt. He will do that within the confines of his scholarly tome and round it off by saying, but faith conquers all, and he believes. Now, of course, for the masses, it has to be black and white. And unfortunately, what theologians will concede in private and in scholarly communities, they will not get up and say in the pulpit. And of course, so, you know, I mean, many people would be shocked to know that Jesus had siblings, but it's there in black and white, because, of course, the average clergyman can rely upon the fact that the average believer doesn't read the book, doesn't read the holy book either. You know, it's far too long and difficult. They stick with the pamphlets, I guess.
And just out of curiosity, what percentage of your mail is hate mail, and how bad does it get?
It's probably not very high. It depends how widely you define the hate mail. I mean, I've got pretty thick skin now, so probably a lot of the damnations are just water off a duck's back. Most of what they write is, of course, pig ignorant. It's so obvious when they say they've read my website. They have probably read one quarter of one page. You know, that's enough for them. You know, it's obviously rubbing them up the wrong way because it's challenging something to which they have a huge psychological attachment. I mean, that is the problem, you see. When I recently spoke up in Scotland to a group of, largely a student community, one of the secular students there, of the secular club, said to me, they find they have to be very careful when disabusing their fellow Christians or their fellow students of their Christian faith, that they don't send them into some depression and, suicidal depression potentially. You know, so you're battling against a great emotional investment. You know, because this is, of course, religion's appeal, isn't it? It taps very deep into the human psyche. And it probably has to be said, most people would find life without it a bit bleak. In fact, I've had some correspondents quite happily say to me they would rather go on believing a lie. They don't want me to analyze it and shred it to pieces. You know, leave the lie alone. We like it. Yeah, it's despairing, really. Because my answer to that is, if we left ignorance to be ignorant because they felt happy that way, we would still be living in caves. Only by challenging, and investigating and discovery do we advance. You know, clergymen used to perform medical, well, they couldn't call it operations, but you used, the Bible actually tells you, go to a priest to solve a medical problem. You know, would we really want to do that? Would any clergyman actually do that?
Well, Ken, I think that's all the time we have today. I'd like to thank you very much for coming on and bringing a lot of your eloquence, sapience, and wit to the show.
Well, it's been a great pleasure. The time rushes by, doesn't it? I'm just getting warmed up here.
Yeah, exactly. Well, we've been over it an hour, but it's just so much. But for the listener, all you have to do is go to JesusNeverExisted.com and... we've touched the tip of the iceberg. You'll get a lot more to it. So I guess that's the best we can do right now, Ken.
Well, that's great. Let me just answer completely what you said about the second book. It should be out early in the spring. Jesus All Never right, Existed Ken. Part 2. He still does
Right to
exist.
The point. Yeah, right to the point. All right, Ken. Well, thank you very much.
It's a pleasure.
And we will hopefully have you on soon, or we'll definitely have you on soon when the second book comes out.
Excellent. I look forward to it.
And there you have it, my beloved True Seekers. Ken Humphreys, author of Jesus Never Existed, taking apologists to the woodshed and doing things to them like the dude did to Steve Buscemi in the movie Fargo. Take what you want from it, and certainly don't take our words for it. Do your own homework and find clarity of mind. Personally, I'm a mythicist, as I've explained before, but whether Jesus existed or not really has no bearing whatsoever on me accessing the Logos, the concert of Mother Sophia. And Ken is so right about people who would prefer to live a lie. After all, who really wants to leave the Matrix, their own personal Truman Show, the land of the Lotus Eaters, Rivendell, or the lower skies where the winds are milder and the view is so cool? But a prison is still a prison, regardless of how polished the bars are and the food is good. Some of us just want to spread our wings wider. Sorry for the cliche. Ken Humphrey's website is JesusNeverExisted.com. I always advise people to sharpen their minds by studying the historical method and logical fallacies in our various battles against intolerant fundamentalists and even rabid secularists. The information is on the web, right at your fingertips. The Gnostics were rational in studying the material as well as the immaterial world. You can't be prepared enough, my beloved True Seekers. The more enlightened we get, the more the cosmos will use different snipers from different buildings of life. So fight the good fight, finish the race, and keep the faith. And to the Gnostic, the only faith we have is faith in our experiences, whether they may be mystical or earthly. In the meantime, let's keep playing our tunes. I am, and I am Abraxas, broadcast from the virtual Alexandria through the GodAboveGod.com. The road is ended, the song is over. Thought I'd have something more to say. But don't cultivate any troubles, my beloved True Seekers, because like heaven above you, the spy that loved you, I'm keeping